Years in prison in horrible conditions, totally isolated. When he became president, he decided not to take his salary and to donate 70% of it to good social causes. He decided not to move to the presidential mansion and to stay living in his farm without any kind of people to serve him, without police protection, because he said that if a president needs a police to protect himself or herself, doesn't deserve to be president. And with a three-legged dog, as you read in the news, I guess. So all that is true. The problem is that he has presented himself as the champion of anti-consumerism and the champion of environmental causes. But he hasn't really did much when he was in government to change the extractivist model, which in the case of Uruguay is not about mining, it's not about oil, it's about what we call the green desert, the huge extension of soya production and forest production. For instance, to produce a paper mill for Finnish plant. And also there was a proposal by an Indian mining company to open an open pit, huge mining project in Uruguay, in a country that has almost no history of mining. And Mujica was very happy with that, because he said that we need the resources for the transition. So, to some extent he has a point, we need resources for the transition, but we were not so sure that this was the best way to get the resources. The other failure that we have seen not only in Uruguay, but also in Argentina, for instance, where a lot of former guerrilla fighters went into government during the Kirchner period, former Montoneros in the case of Argentina, is that the whole mentality of the guerrilla continues to be active among these people. And for instance, Mujica appointed as Minister of Defense another former guerrilla fighter. We were all surprised about that and fearful about what happened, but the military loved this Minister of Defense. It was their favorite Minister of Defense. And that was because after being appointed as minister, this guy, a former guerrilla fighter, say, we have to forget all our division, we were all fighters in the war, and you as military and we as the guerrilla, we were all fighting for the same cause. We were concerned about the homeland. It was very dangerous because he also accused the NGOs and human rights organizations that were still struggling to send some military that had done horrible human rights violations in the dictatorship to court, and suddenly we were accused of being the allies of the US imperialism and being against the good army and so on. So that's the other thing I would criticize about. Oh yeah, yeah, and there was a final question about regional integration. Yeah, before the left came into government, there was an interesting project that was the Mercosur, the common market of the South, that was more or less inspired in the European Union. The idea was that at the beginning it would be a free trade area, then would become a customs union, finally it would become some kind of economic or even political union as the European Union. In practice, after many years, the Mercosur remains something like a free trade area and a very unfunctional custom union, but no more than that. But we still need the Mercosur. With all the criticism, some of us in the left believe that we shouldn't get rid of the Mercosur, we should change it from within. And we could have some discussion similar about the European Union, but that's another presentation, another discussion. But there have been attempts to create things different to traditional free trade agreements, such as Mercosur, and that was done by the Bolivarian countries. So there was this proposal of creating ALBA, the Bolivarian Alternatives for the Americas, and more recently, there was also the creation of UNASUR and CELADE. UNASUR is the South American Union of Nations, which is quite interesting because it's a political forum without the interference of the United States and Canada. And there is also CELADE, which is the community of Latin American and Caribbean countries. So it's not just South America, also includes the Caribbean. That is another political forum that also allows Latin American countries to solve their internal differences without the interference of Washington and Ottawa. In the case of Venezuela, we could have some criticism about the way it was implemented, but there was a quite solidarity movement in terms of supporting small and poorer nations of the Caribbean, providing cheap oil for these countries in the context of Petrocaribe, which is an alliance. It's a, in paper, it's a transnational corporation run by the different governments of the region, led by Venezuela. Your question was about the drivers. I think the main driver was the struggles against neoliberalism. This is something that is common in all the political projects that finally got in Latin America. But when you look at the different agents behind the struggles against neoliberalism, we see a lot of variation. For instance, in the context of the SADRCOM, we see the gradual electoral accumulation of institutionalized political parties. Left parties that pre-existed, in some cases for many decades, that were accumulating more and more votes until finally they won the election and they got into power. In the case of the Andean countries, it was rather different. Because in the case of Venezuela, nobody knew Chavez before he came into power. It was the result of some insurgency that had happened some years before, El Caracazo, that was a huge popular uprising against neoliberalism that ended with 362 registered deaths a few years before Chavez came into government. And the case of Ecuador and Bolivia, there was a very strong indigenous people's movement that were not really organized as political parties, but were a movement. You can see that even in the name of the organization. In the case of Bolivia, it's not a party, it's the movement toward socialism. So in terms of political agents, we see quite a lot of variation.
Thank you very much.
I would like to know what the importance be of the notion of buen vivir, which you taught, for creating alternatives to extractivist modes of production. And if there already are particular strategies or visions based on conception of buen vivir, how would they look like? That's my question.
Thank you. I would like to go back to the concept of participatory budgeting. Could you say a little bit more the extent to which this concept has been taken up by other countries in Latin America? And you also made a distinction between the European left and Latin American left. If I characterize it correctly, you mentioned that, of course, the European left is much more urbanized, is more directed into Europe, urban politics in a sense. Isn't that something that Latin American countries in general can regain back by going back to this concept of participatory budgeting? Thank you.
Maya?
Thank you. I'd like to ask you about the current situation which we have been reading in the news. But before that, like Evo Morales has this, in 2010 they passed the law on the rights of the Mother Earth and saying that if pigs can have rights, why not the Mother Earth can have rights? But then we have now the new left government in Ecuador, Lenin Moreno, and then in Bolivia. The recent news where in the recent newspapers they were talking about the Chinese oil company and the team of the Chinese oil company encountering with the indigenous people, both in Ecuador and Bolivia, and indigenous people have been really expressing their discontent with the government, and in case of Ecuador, with the new government. And what's the situation? And is this because not it might not be probably ideological, but because of, as you mentioned, this dichotomy of USA, China, and geopolitical interests they take into account? So what are your reflections?
Yeah, very briefly, the question about when we build. This was quite interesting, very interesting actually, in theory. And when we look at the text of the constitution of Venezuela, Bolivia, and Ecuador, we will see that they surely rank among the most progressive and inclusive constitutional of the whole world. So there's a lot of recognition of new rights and of different rights. The problem is that, I was looking at him, you made a question. The problem is that in practice, the Constitution has remained, in many cases, a wet paper, because what is written in the Constitution is not always applied in real life, in daily life. But having said that, there has been some progress. For instance, in the case of Bolivia, there have been many cases of progressive legislation, as I mentioned before, to give more rights to indigenous community. Some of these decisions were quite controversial because, for instance, indigenous communities were given the right to have their own justice system, more or less what the Manana was talking yesterday about Spanitia, I think. This was very much resisted, but according to what I have read, these indigenous popular community-based justice system are indeed functional. And in some cases they are more functional and efficient than the state. In terms of environmental protection, there is a huge contradiction. Because at the same time that the Bolivian constitution includes explicit reference to the protection of Pachamama, Mother Nature, there have been attempts to build a highway through a protected national park against the opposition of the indigenous community living in that part of Bolivia. And we can refer to similar contradictions in Ecuador and in Venezuela. Even though Venezuela doesn't explicitly refer to what we did, but there are similar ideas in their own constitutional text. The question about participatory budgeting. At a certain moment, it was very extensive, the application of participatory budgeting in Latin America. Almost every major and middle-sized city covered by the left was implementing some kind of participatory budgeting. And there was also a lot of experimentation and adaptation of the original idea of participatory budgeting. In some cases, for instance, participatory budgeting expanded to digital participation, making sure that people who usually don't go to neighborhood assemblies would have a way to have their voice heard, and in some other interesting innovation. The problem is that, as I mentioned before, that then the World Bank, UNDP, the OECD published their own handbooks about how to run that became a problem, because in some cases, for instance, in Peru, where the left is not in government, has not been in government, Bolivia, also in Venezuela, but let's see the case of Peru or Dominican Republic, national law were approved, forcing every municipality to have a process of participatory budgeting as a mandatory condition to get funding from the national state. And that was very problematic because participatory budgeting became a fiction, something that you have to do because there was a law that required you to do that, but without any kind of real political will to transfer decision-making power to the people, to the citizens. In terms of what you mentioned about the distinction between the European left and the Latin American left in the recognition of urban politics, I was not only referring to the significance of the municipal level, but more to the way of doing politics. For instance, in the case of Barcelona and Madrid, we are not talking about a political party, we are talking more about a platform that allows the convergence of different cultures of the left, different sensibilities, and also different forms of organizations to join together to go ahead with that political project. So it's much more dynamic, much more flexible, much more open to innovation than the traditional party-centered, party-driven forms of politics. That's why I thought we have a lot to learn from the new European left in terms of city politics and urban politics. Your question about Ecuador and the rise of Mother Earth and the Chinese and so on, I fully agree with your diagnosis. It's really like that. First, I should clarify that many Latin American feminists are quite unhappy with the concept of Pachamama and the rise of Mother Earth because they argue, and I think they are right, this idea essentializes the role of women as mother, and that's problematic, according to many of my feminist friends. Their argument is much more complex, and why summarizing it, but this is the idea. But I think most popular organizations have become aware, going to the second part of your question, that there is no real distinction in the objectives and the forms of engagement with local population. There is no distinction between an American transnational corporation, a European transnational corporation, and a Chinese transnational corporation. And if we look at the case of Peru, which is something that I have been following, I can tell you that the Chinese can be much more aggressive than the American and European in the way they relate with the local
community.
Thank you for a very nice presentation. Sorry. One thing I really want to understand how the Latin American labs are addressing the idea of the BRICS, which is like was some kind of the invention of the social movements and in a way that now the same social movements and NGOs are really trying to stop its activity more or less, and how and it's a continuation of the same maybe because it's still the not the very case, but it looks like more and more transnational corporations from the Latin America now will start to invest in the other parts of the world, in like Petrobras in Africa, but I think this is like the beginning. So do there is any kind of the understanding that Latin America are simply repeating the model of the US and China?
Marlo, when tweeted that this sign there, so Plazar of Ortega Salvador, Salvador Trump, is outcrops, was never trained about the outcrops, was never trained at all, but not since after, but subsequently, trend to start as a tip as the outcrops, trend are partly as far as from Marco, which is sort of as a cow going from the way at the Aries, so it's Aria that we never know if never trained was a tip rather than Aria that we never know if it's a ultra liberal ideas at the last shendek. Funsana, Salvatar, Jasna, Cartoon, 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 dok se naravno pa tamo si da vas ne vas ne obiš pa tvorča Petrovac si je sam tu Amelios za sva Franco za lepši a dok sad pa sa Martin institucija da se sva da kraj klas je puca i si na mene pa im im se u cijeli sada sam su promeni tamo si da vas pa kolo po 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 mu ne znam ba gete vena pa pa ti al
Yeah, the question about BRICS, I will dare to say that there isn't much discussion about BRICS in Latin America. I'm sure there is a lot of discussion in Brazil because they are directly involved in the BRICS project. And BRICS, in case somebody doesn't know, refer to Brazil, Russia, India, and China, and South Africa. And also in Latin America, we have a previous history of debates around the concept of sub-imperialism, which is a concept that some people in Africa already have in relation to the power of South Africa. We do it in relation to the power of Brazil. So we are always concerned about the role of Brazil in the region, because any government in Brazil can have a Latin Americanist will, but they always have their own national project. And when you look at the history of foreign policy in Brazil, regardless of the color and the shape of the government of the time, they have been quite coherent. And their foreign service is extremely efficient, and they are very much concerned about protecting their national project. We haven't had much discussion about BRICS, but we have had a lot of discussion about the power of one specific Brazilian bank, which is BNDES in English, is the National Development Bank, which is actually not a national bank, because when you look at the capital amount that this bank manages, it's larger than the Inter-American Development Bank. And it's run by the Brazilian government. And they have been supporting very controversial infrastructure projects of every kind across Latin America. For instance, this highway through a national park in Bolivia that I was referring to would be funded by this Brazilian development bank. And I think, Manana, you're very right when we look at the increasing power of some big Latin American-based transnational corporation. We could talk about Petrobras, but we could also talk about Grupo Carso from Mexico, in the telecommunication sector. We could talk about EPM from Medellin in the energy sector, and so on. And it's true what you say. Once they expand outside their homeland, they tend to behave like any other transnational corporation. We refer in Spanish to these companies as multi-Latina. Multi comes from multinational corporation, Latinas from Latin America. And the question about top left, top right, I have to clarify that that's not my expression. I plagiarized it from the title of a book of a friend of mine, Patrick Paul. This is the title of his book, Talk Left, Walk Right, and it's a biography of Thabo Mbeki, the former president of South Africa, who was also the leader of the African National Council. So I cannot comment about the Georgian case because I have no idea. In the case of Nicaragua, I think there are many explanations about why it is happening. He needs to preserve his left discourse because economically Nicaragua was until very recently extremely dependent on Venezuelan help, not only in terms of oil but also financial contribution, direct financial contribution. So he needs to appear as leftist, socialist, Bolivarian, whatever. He also had to sign, or well, he didn't capture, but he decided to join this free trade agreement with the US and Europe, so he needs to walk right. He also had this crazy project that will never be implemented of building a canal through Nicaragua that would be funded by the Chinese. So he needs to be trying to be good to many different partners at the same time, and telling them what they want to hear. At the national level, he's not so much concerned about what he says, because there is some kind of strict control by the Sandinista now in Nicaragua. It is becoming very much a one-party society. Any other kind of party in the left or in the right would have very hard to compete with the Sandinistas right now, including direct repression. So he's not concerned about what happened at the national level. It's quite funny because when you travel through Nicaragua, you see this big billboard everywhere that refers to Nicaragua, Sandinista, socialist, and Christian. Because he built this very crazy alliance with Juan Cardinal, who was the main critic of the Sandinistas during the Sandinista Revolution. And this Cardinal was also a supporter of the Contra-Revolution. But now they are the best friend.
Thank you very much, Kalin Matuba. Საინტერესო დისკუსიის წამახალისებელი პრეზენტაციისთვის და პასუხებისთვის მგონია, რომ კიდევ ბევრი კითხვა დარჩება შეიძლება შესვენების დროს დავუსვა დანიელ ჩარლზს, ნებაყოფლობით მაინტერესებს საკითხები, რა გავლენა აქვს თუნდაც მემარცხენე შემოწმებულობა და ფემინიზმის და თუნდაც რელიგიის საკითხები როგორ შეიძლება აღწერილობაში. Ახლა კი შესვენების დრო არის, ჩვენ 10 წუთი გადავაწილეთ და ამ შემდეგ სესია დაიწყება 12:20-ზე დააკლდება. მანამდე კი მინდა გთხოვოთ შეავსოთ შეფასების ფუნქციები, რომლებიც გუშინ დაგირიგეთ და აი მწვანე კალათაში ჩააბარდოთ. ეს უბრალოდ ძალიან დაგვეხმარება ჩვენ შემდგომი მწვანე აკადემიის დაგეგმვაში, იმიტომ რომ ეს არ არის მხოლოდ ჯერადი გონისება, რომ სამი წელი ვაკეთებ და ვაპირებ კიდე გავავრცელებ. თქვენი მონაწილეობა ძალიან მნიშვნელოვანია, რომ უკეთესი და უკეთესი გამოვიდეს ეს წონეთა ფენ.
Махо давала я где верц შენი ნაკომისი კიდევ გასამყარებლად ჩვენ ამას ყოველდღიურად ევალუაციის სახით ვკითხულობთ და გვაინტერესებს თქვენი აზრი და სხვადასხვა თავი შეიძლება იყოს დროის მენეჯმენტი რაც ერთის ხო სასიამოვნოა იმის თვალსაც რომ სხვა თქვენ კატასტროფის შეცდომები ჯერჯერობით ორგანიზატორებს არ დაგუშვია ზოგიერთი შეჩვის გარდა რომელსაც ასე გავითვალისწინებთ